with your lifestyle, mm-hmm. like, for example, active physical lifestyle and reduction mm-hmm. of fruit sugar consumption, you are reducing the risk that you yourself, and also because you affect the genes of your future, of your future daughters as well,
yes.
and children as well, that you will develop polycystic ovaries.
Thank you for being with us today, Dr. Fegerl. Mm-hmm. So we'll start with, how do you know if your hormones are in balance?
Hormones are produced by your body, and your body is trying with the performance of the hormones to stimulate either this organ or this function to improve and to accelerate, or another function to, for example, to rest. A very simple example is the cortisol that is produced in the morning allows us to wake after 8 hours of sleep, and I can start my day energetically. And the melatonin that is produced then at the end of the day is allowing me to rest and to sleep, to find recovery during the nighttime.
Yes.
If I do experience that one of my performances, normal metabolic acts or the rhythms in my life, no matter if it is now the menstrual rhythm or if it is the daily, the circadian rhythm, is somehow disturbed or is not working properly, this is then the moment when you should consider a testing, a laboratory testing maybe, and the consultation of a physician to check your hormones to be in a normal and physiological range or not.
Okay. So what do you mean when you say the test that one of the rhythms of the body is not working?
If you find it, for example, difficult to awake in the morning, for example, 2 years ago, that was absolutely not a problem. That is something. If you do suffer from sleeping issues, and those sleeping issues are not based on a higher number of concerns, for example, or restlessness of the feet, it is just not, you are experiencing that you are not able to rest anymore successfully. Or with women or young women, but also with the more experienced women, changes in the menstrual cycle, they cannot explain with changes in life's lifestyle, for example, or the years they are alive.
What is the earliest age that these symptoms can show up?
Hormone imbalance in early childhood is normally first visible as a delay in growth of height, or a delay in development of age-adequate muscles, for example. If children stay very childish, although they are 11 or 12 or 13 years of age, that is something that shows, or that could be a sign for a delayed start of a sexual hormone production, for example. If children in the kindergarten or in the nursery are significantly smaller than the other children the same age, please consult a pediatric, and the pediatric will compare the size and the weight and the strength of your children to the statistic mean, and is then measuring them as to be either fitting in a certain percentile or not. And accordingly, you are changing then the recommendation of what hormones should be tested and what hormones not.
Okay. If they are out of balance, what is the best way then of getting them back in balance?
That very much depends on the hormone and the reason why the hormones are out of balance. For example, the most common reason for a hormonal imbalance is stress. Yeah?
Right.
And starvation. This is what we very often find with the teenagers. If they are unhappy with the way of how the body is looking like, because they are feeling themselves to be overweight, for example, they stop eating very often. And if they at the same time also do intensive physical activity and exercise, they are producing at the same time a high amount of stress. And that is, in case of girls, for example, immediately stopping their ability to be fertile. Or in other words, their menstrual cycle will stop immediately.
Right.
Another thing is, for example, if boys or girls are unhappy, stressed because of the divorce of parents or because of the pandemic situation, for example, they stop physical activity and try to compensate this unhappiness and uncertainty by eating a lot of food or comfort food.
Right.
And with that, they are making the body experience a lot of inflammation because of the indigestion. Right. But because of this stress and inflammation inside of the body, the hormone balance is changing, and they become very often estrogen dominant. And with the estrogen dominance, the boys, for example, are not developing muscles enough. They stay small, become a little bit obese. And the girls, for example, also experience a change in the menstrual circle with very painful and very strenuous menstrual bleeding, and especially a PMS, a premenstrual syndrome, with massive pain and fatigue and spasms. Those are all signs for a hormonal imbalance. So in other words, if you allow me, if the hormones are out of balance, you experience your body not to be in balance. Be not anxious if changes in the routine are changing your reactivity, your metabolic state. That is just physiological. But if without any experienceable triggers to affecting you, you are still in an extraordinary metabolic or emotional state, this is then the moment when you please should contact your GP to do a proper hormonal testing.
Do you think we should be proactive with young girls and check before we see symptoms?
Very important for me is because polycystic ovaries are very common. They are not limiting and reducing your lifespan. Not from the point of scientific knowledge right now. So please don't panic. And if someone is suffering from polycystic ovaries, it does not mean that this woman will not be able to conceive, for example, or give birth to children and become a grandmother, for example, or that this woman is infertile or will always suffer from pain. That is not the case. So very often, I meet very often clients that are carrying the diagnosed PCOD in front of them. And so, yes, that's not important. That's not right. Polycystic ovary syndrome or polycystic ovaries mean there are cysts on the ovaries, or examine this with an ultrasonic test.
Right.
And you can make them visible. Secondly, if you measure in the blood the sexual hormones at a special state of the hormonal cycle, you will find the androgens. Right. You will find the estrogen to be on the higher side. That is a criteria. And the third thing is pain before the menstruation in a higher amount and quality. That is also normally a sign for a polycystic ovary, together with no ovulation at all. The ovulation is normally taking place at day 15 of the menstrual cycle. Day 15 of the menstrual cycle means you count, or you start counting, with the first day of menstruational bleeding. Uh-huh. And day at around day 15, you have the higher state of estrogen inside of the female body. And this means an ovular follicle is ripening and then popping and bursting.
Right.
And this can cause an irritation and a pain, normally typically on either the one or the other side, left or right.
Right.
And this is showing the moment when the body is starting to produce more and more progesterone. Mm-hmm. And is reducing its production of estrogen or the androgens. The classic risk factor for the polycystic ovary syndrome or polycystic ovaries is obesity and the consumption of fructose or fruit sugar. Yes. There are others that can accelerate the development of cysts and an androgen dominance inside of the female body, like, for example, a dysbiosis in the intestine. That means a fungal overgrowth, for example, after the usage of antibiotics. Something I very often see with Indian and Asian, but also US American clients that are taking antibiotics once they suffer from a bronchitis, for example, or congestion and coughing. With an antibiotic treatment, you affect the microbiome inside of the gut. Right. You're stimulating a fungal overgrowth, and the fungal overgrowth is physiologically leading to an estrogen dominance, to an androgen dominance. That is aggravating polycystic ovaries.
Would you suggest that the young girls get checked beforehand, or should one wait for symptoms?
I think the most important, the way of how you can support your daughter or your granddaughter the best possible way is that you yourself and the girl are physically active. Yeah. Take her for a walk every day. Yeah, not spinning, but take her for a walk every day for 1 hour. And it's very unlikely that she will develop a polycystic ovaries. And the other thing is, fruits are high valuable source of antioxidants and vitamins. They are fantastic. But they are containing a form of sugar that requires all of our digestive possibilities and tools to transform it into something that is beneficial for us and protecting us from turning the fructose into something harmful for the liver. That's important to know, because if our liver is struggling, it is very often that our body is then storing some special sugars, macro sugars, inside of the ovaries, what is leading them to a buildup of cystic formations inside.
Right.
So please, if you are concerned because of the health of your daughter, but it's also true for the health of your son, don't offer them dried fruits. Try to reduce the consumption of fruit juices, especially watermelon juice, pomegranate juice, and honey also. And the third is fruits, yes, but in smart quantities. That maybe means maybe one portion a day. That would be fine.
Okay.
There are of course also rare polycystic ovary diseases existing that are related to an hereditary factor. Mm-hmm. Yeah, if your mother, for example, suffered from it, it is of course increasing a little bit the chance that you are developing it. But look, your genes, you have, you can affect the performance of your genes through epigenetics. And epigenetics means with your lifestyle, like for example, active physical lifestyle and reduction of fruit sugar consumption, you are reducing the risk that you yourself, and also because you affect the genes of your future, of your future daughters as well, and children as well, that you will develop polycystic ovaries.
And if someone does have it, what do you recommend they do for it?
Physical activity, maybe practicing intermittent fasting. That means you are fasting for 16 to 18 hours a day. That would be nice. And in those six to eight hours where you are eating, please don't compensate on the meals that you passed and all the foods that you missed, but enjoy really a good variety in foods, not too many fruits, and stay away from juices. That would be great. In this combination, you can protect yourself very well and you can support yourself very well. You can, of course, then also use herbs. You can, of course, also use the very intensive antifungal treatment to get free yourself from possible other triggers, like, for example, the fungal overgrowth. Example, or you can help yourself with the intake of bitter herbs like bittergut or chlorella or Agnus castus to make the body experience a high increase of the progesterone or the gastrogens. That is, of course, also possible to make you experience less symptoms and it is and allowing your body to find back into a rhythm.
A lot of people are trying to have kids and it seems to be becoming more and more difficult. Now, very often people just say it's lifestyle. It'd be interesting to hear what you have to say about fertility.
The fact that a woman or a couple is conceiving first and then receiving a child, that is a blessing. Overall, it is a wonder and it's a miracle. So none of us is having right on that. But there are a few factors we can influence very positive to increase the chance that it is happening. For conceiving, it is important that the body of the woman is a good potential nest. And the nest is built not on the windy place of a tree, but on the safe and cozy side of a tree. So if the woman is experiencing a lot of stress, emotional stress, or also the stress through an increase of environmental pollution, the stress of suffering from a lot of indigestion and maldigestion, for example, the stress of inflammation caused by an injury, by a hormonal imbalance, for example. Although, or also, again, the stress of not sleeping enough or being immobile, not physically active. That is making it more difficult for a woman to conceive.
Right.
And we do know in Austria, for example, that the infertility is in more than 50% are caused by the male infertility.
Yes.
Also,
yes.
Men have the duty and have the possibility to increase their fertility, the fertility and the activity of the sperms by being physically active, reducing inflammation in their body. That is very important because men are building continuously sperms. So the sperms that I use to impregnate the, my wife and my partner, for example, were built today or maybe the last few days.
Right.
So the way of how I lift there is affecting dramatically the quality of the sperms. So please, men, we are in duty and in responsibility to increase our fertility and not only blame our woman, wives.
No, that's a very good point.
Being responsible.
So do you think a simple diagnostic blood test is useful to start with or not?
Important is really a proper examination
with
a woman, with women, especially an ultrasonic examination of the pelvic organs, the ovaries, the tubes, the uterus, an examination and an assessment through asking questions.
Right.
Yeah. It is possible that someone is not ready to conceive because a private situation is too stressful. Okay. It's not right. Yeah.
Okay. What is your view on menopause and on HRT, which is what every woman asks at some stage in her life?
It is the hormonal change. The menopause is a hormonal change, and the hormonal change is not an illness. And it is not a sign of a character weakness. If some women are suffering from more problems and symptoms than other women, it's not a sign for vitality if you experience no symptoms. It's just a
it's just life and luck. Yeah, absolutely.
So, the hormonal change is affecting your metabolism. It is affecting your hormones, of course. It's affecting your libido, your stress resistance. It is affecting your ability to perform and your ability to also rest. In this situation, you notice changes of your body and changes also in your mind. If a change is causing immediately a stress reaction inside of you, please start to read a little bit, inform yourself about the hormonal change to relax a little bit. Yeah. Because again, a hormonal change is not a disease. Secondly, if the symptoms are pushing you that far and that much out of your state of well-being that you say, my life is holding no quality, and I'm experiencing myself to be pushed out of health, then please contact your physician, do a proper examination, do also a testing of your hormones. In my experience, best possible would be if you test your hormones at around day 23, 24 of your menstrual cycle.
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
Because this is the moment where most likely the estrogen and the progesterone are the highest, and then slow decrease of the progesterone is becoming visible the earliest and understandable. And in this situation, and after this examination, you can discuss either herbal or also you can discuss bioidentical hormone replacement therapy. The classic hormone replacement therapy with synthetic hormones, normally not supporting. Because a hormone is something that is an effect on the body, but not only stimulating, but also calming effect. You need the hormone to have a negative feedback on the body at the same time, not only stimulation. Because with just stimulation, you suddenly experience then the negative side effects of a hormonal treatment. Whereas the bioidentical hormones, for example, or also hormones or hormonal-like phytotherapeutics, that means herbal remedies, they are not only stimulating, but also calming at the same time. So that the chance that you experience a negative side effect of a hormonal therapy are going almost down to zero. It is, of course, possible that you are not liking the way of how it is affecting you. This is why I would recommend that really the consultation, the guidance therapist.
Yes.
To find for you the right remedy. It's a little bit like it is with food. Yeah? What is good experienced by your neighbor or your sister can cause a lot of harm inside of your body. Or if it is not causing harm, at least it is not making you experience this the success you are expecting. So please consult as someone who is knowing and who is experienced in treating clients either herbal or also with acupuncture, for example, or acupressure, or also bioidentical hormones. But the step number one is, if you experience a hormonal change, no panic and take over control up to a certain point, not punishing yourself with physical activity and exercise, but be a little bit more physically active, reduce inflammation as much as possible inside of your body by avoiding maldigestion, avoid poisons as good as possible, that is alcohol, that is nicotine, that is caffeine, and also reduce a little bit the overall amount of caloric intake. That is easiest by reducing the consumption of juices, no matter of how well meant the smoothie is that you are consuming. Reduce it then in this situation.
Okay. Should there be a general diet to be followed during perimenopause?
Maybe to name, so to explain it like that. The hormonal change is leading to a change inside of your body and inside of your body's performance and organs' performances. Right. That means it is changing the way of how well you digest something and how well you metabolize or how well you react on a stressful situation. So if you already know what is putting stress on you because you are not digesting it well or not feeling well by consuming it or after consuming it, please avoid this, at least in your daily routine. It's not necessary to ban it completely out of your life, but create yourself a routine at home that is as friendly as possible, containing foods you find easy to digest, introducing maybe a little bit of intermittent fasting, avoid a little bit spices that are making hot and dry, a good amount of water, hydrate yourself in between the meals, because water is very important. It is allowing us and our organs to exchange and to get rid of metabolic waste, to avoid also the water retention inside of the body. It is important to have a good amount of water. The more hydrated you are, the less likely is it that you develop water retention. And in the diet, please avoid poison and caffeine as good as possible. The easiest would be that you just, for example, perform the intermittent fasting. Yeah, skip one meal and you, at the end of the month, will have consumed less calories than you consumed before that. That is the easiest. And I'm not a big fan of diet in a way to count then the calories. Please really have good meals, but chew them and consume them with awareness. Have small bites of them. Smell them if they attract you nicely. Enjoy them. Stop eating the moment you feel warm and relaxed inside of your stomach. Don't wait for this feeling of bursting and bloated stomach. That was just too much. A meal should make you feel afterwards more alive than before. It is possible that that the uterus is building kind of tumors, benign tumors of the muscle inside. Yeah, the uterus is size of a pear, and it's built up by a very strong muscle tissue. Mm-hmm. And this muscle tissue can include some tumors. And the tumor is, of course, and resistance that is experienced as a disturbance by this big muscle, especially then when the body or the uterus tries to remove the mucosa skin, the mucosa linen inside during the menstrual cycle. Then you always experience this tumor as to be a disturbance that can lead to a prolonged menstrual bleeding, and that can exhaust a lot. If someone is experiencing that, please, treatment number one is take a good dosage of magnesium, around 400 milligram a day, that is helping your muscle to relax.
Right. Okay.
Drink a good amount of water, that is important, and be physical active, not like crazy, but really walking, especially on those days of menstrual bleeding, because with the physical activity, you are oxygenating all the muscles in the best possible way. And if they are well oxygenated, they are not tending to cramp. And if they are not cramping, this muscle tumor, yeah, or this adenomyosis is not disturbing as much.
Okay.
And you can relax.
Lifestyle or food recommendations for breast cancer diagnosis. It seems like one in every few women are being diagnosed with breast cancer. So firstly, why is that happening? And secondly, what should one do?
This is still topic of scientific research all over the globe, why the number of breast cancers are going high. It for sure has something to do with inflammation inside of the body.
Okay.
And inflammation, again, is stress is another word for inflammation. Yeah.
Okay.
Metabolic stress. That means the inability to nourish myself or also to perform according to my evolutionary plan, for example, to be physically active. The stress of living in a more and more polluted environmental condition. The stress of being not nourished enough, that my foods are not satisfying my need for nutrients and trace elements especially. The stress of being more alert and longer awake than the time that I allow myself to rest throughout the night. Mm-hmm. Melatonin is the sleeping hormone. And melatonin is a very strong antioxidant and is affecting women struggling with breast cancer normally in a very positive way, because it is allowing them to experience longer hours of repair and also of regeneration and defense, of course.
Okay.
If someone is suffering already from cancer, please don't starve yourself, but make your body experience as often as possible really hours where you are not consuming food or consuming juices. Allow yourself really to do the intermittent fasting, because your immune system is your protection against cancer. And if your immune system has to protect you against the food that you consume and the outer world that you consume through the act of eating a meal, it is not strong in defending you against the cancer at the same time. Right. So either do the one or the other. And if you nourish yourself with awareness and in a relaxed state and allow your body then time enough to digest and to rebalance and metabolize what you consume, you have consumed, you strengthen yourself and prepare yourself in the best possible way to protect, so to fight the cancer as good as possible. When it comes to special foods and cancer, I would recommend, especially with breast cancer, to avoid everything that is whitish, creamy, cold, and slimy. In other words, no yogurt, no curd, no sour cream, for example, no paneer, please.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
No milk. And also not to substitute those substances and foods directly with, for example, coconut yogurt or almond milk. Because from the energetic understanding, breast cancer, there are different types of breast cancer, but breast cancer is taking place in an organ that is a gland. And if you confront the gland with something that is sticky and creamy, you make the gland be blocked. And when the gland is blocked, you stop the exchange. And if the exchange is stopped, you have an environmental condition that is supporting cancer and is not helping cancer. That is not a very medical explanation. That is more often of an energetic explanation.
Yes.
You will find this this explanation also, for example, in the traditional Chinese medicine. Mm-hmm. In China, you say the breast cancer is a rich woman disease because the rich woman is living the Western lifestyle, consuming milk.
If it's breast cancer along with a lupus diagnosis,
we still not 100% understand lupus. If you allow me to cut a long story short, lupus is inflammation. Do reduce inflammation inside of your body. And the big inflammation, lupus, will also be affected through this reduction in a positive way. And when I mention inflammation, please consider the triggers that I mentioned before, like pollution, stress, not resting enough, consumption of food that you don't digest, dehydration, for example, just be stopped.
Okay. Yoga practice help with hormone balancing?
Of course. With yoga, you reduce stress. And like I told you, stress is the most common reason for hormonal imbalance. It is beautifully supporting. It is not always the solution, because it can be that you are either hereditary or because of an accident or an hormonal condition, not able to keep the hormonal balance. This is why I would kindly ask you, if you suspect yourself to suffer from a hormonal imbalance without detecting or without feeling connected to one of the triggers that might have caused it. If you are uncertain what is causing it, then please contact a physician and let's start a proper examination on that.
I wanted to know about lime and lemon for cancer mm-hmm. treatments, because you're saying they have a lot of it.
Also, beetroot, I'm not very much aware of a huge hormonal effect. It's maybe that the beetroot is containing a higher level of fructose inside fruit sugar, and with that, again, affecting the androgens, the estrogen-alike hormones, to be increased. That is the one thing. Secondly, with lime and lemon juice. Lime and lemon juice, if you consume small quantities of that prior to a meal, you increase your digestive strength. And with that, you make it more likely that you digest foods rich in proteins easier and more complete. So with that, you can support your digestion of protein bombs. But to cure cancer with lime and lemon, not that I know of. Yeah, sometimes high dosage vitamin C therapy is recommended by me or through me and my colleagues. But this is a decision or a recommendation that is based on a proper examination and individually given. And to do high dosage vitamin C therapy with the consumption of lemon, that is impossible. You would need to consume more than 200 a day, and no one would feel comfortable with it.
You were talking just now about, you said cardiovascular disease. Mm-hmm. Did you mean calcification of arteries?
The cardiovascular event is, for example, a stroke, is a myocardial infarction that can be caused by atherosclerosis. Atherosclerosis is an inflammatory change inside of the vessels, producing a stenosis more and more. But a cardiovascular event can also be caused by an angina pectoris, for example. That means a spastic reaction of the coronary arteries, mm-hmm. blocking the blood circulation for a certain period of time. And both causes of a cardiovascular event can be caused by becoming more likely if someone is experiencing a high calcification.
A lot of elderly people take glucosamine sulfate tablet supplementation for bone wear and tear. Mm-hmm. What is your opinion on this?
you can take chondroitin sulfate and glucosamine acid, for example, to support the nourishment of your cartilage in the joint. And glucosamine acid, okay, they are nourishing the cartilage and they are not nourishing the bone. For bone nourishment, you need the physical attraction. That means the physical activity, mm-hmm, the sport, the usage of, of mechanical stress on the bone. That is important. And, of course, vitamin D. If you want to be then very sophisticated, you can add vitamin K2 at the same time. For example, also vitamin A. But if you once got diagnosed to suffer from osteopenia, please consult one of your physicians, mm-hmm, to receive a proper recommendation. And if you don't get a proper recommendation, move your four letters, yeah? Be physically active and tidy up your vitamin D intake.
You give us such a wealth of information. Thank you.
Thank you for listening to this chat. If you enjoyed it, please subscribe to this page. Please subscribe to our podcast on Apple and Spotify, Wellness Curated. And follow us on Instagram, Wellness Curated, 1. Thank you.